Sushruta for Neet is now available on the Google Play Store. Try it out for free.
My dear students, hearty welcome to Janmarga.in class also. I am Professor J.K. Bhatt. Now, in today's class, we shall continue events in sexual reproduction. In the last class, we have studied very clearly how different it is sexual reproduction from that of asexual reproduction. Whether it is a sexual or asexual reproduction, for the reproduction purpose, the organism should reach maturity. After attainment of maturity, all sexually reproducing organisms exhibit events and processes that have remarkable fundamental similarities, even though the structures associated with the sexual reproduction are indeed very different. So, if you look into the structures associated with sexual reproduction, are found to be different in different organisms. Let us see how they are going to be different. Whatever the gonadal structure you come across in cockroach is different from what you have in case of earthworm. So, structures associated with sexual reproduction are different in different organisms. In case of human beings, you know that penis and vulva or vagina, they are involved in sexual reproduction, and such structures are different in case of the fish like a shark. Shark also has a structure which is equivalent to the penis, and these structures are called, can anyone remember? What are the reproductive structures equivalent to penis of human beings in a shark? What are these structures are called? These structures are called claspers. In case of a shark, we come across what is called clasper. Clasper is an intromittent organ. This clasper, there are two claspers in case of this shark fishes, and one of the claspers is introduced into the cloaca of the female shark for the transfer of sperms. So, in this way, structures associated with sexual reproduction are different, very different in different organisms. The events of sexual reproduction, though elaborate and complex, follow a regular sequence. What are these sequences? Sexual reproduction is characterized by the production of gametes, male and female gamete, and their fusion, what we call fertilization, and the formation of zygote and embryogenesis. You see this production of male and female gametes in plants also, and we call that fusion as a pollination to take place prior to the fusion of male and female gametes. And this results in the formation of zygote, and this is followed by embryogenesis, that is formation of embryo. For our convenience, these sequential events are the events which take place one after another, may be grouped into three distinct stages, namely pre-fertilization, fertilization, and post-fertilization events. Pre-fertilization means event that takes place prior to fertilization. Post-fertilization means events that take place after fertilization. So, sexual reproduction can be understood better by studying events occurring during pre-fertilization, fertilization, and post-fertilization. Now, let us look into this one by one. Taking up pre-fertilization, it is not a free fertilization, it's a pre-fertilization. Pre-fertilization is a prior to fertilization. These events include all the events of sexual reproduction prior to the fusion of gametes. You know, fusion of gamete is fertilization. What you come across prior to the fusion of gametes? Formation of the gametes. This formation of gamete is known as gametogenesis. The two main pre-fertilization events, that is prior to fertilization, that is prior to fission gametes, the two main events occurring are, one is gametogenesis, that is formation of gamete, and another one is gamete transfer. For the fertilization to take place, you know, fertilization is nothing but a fusion of gametes. For the fertilization to take place, the gametes must come close to each other. So, these gametes may be produced and released to the water, or they may be introduced very much nearer to the female gamete. And these gametes should be in contact with each other or near to each other before getting into fusion. So, the two main events during pre-fertilization are gametogenesis and gamete transfer. Now let us study gametogenesis. As you are already aware, gametogenesis refers to the process of formation of two types of gametes, male and female. If at all you are asked, what is male sex cell? Male sex cell is also called male gamete, and male gamete is also called sperm. Whether it's the plant or animal, does not matter. So we come across that the formation of male and female gametes, male gamete is called sperm and female gamete is called egg in case of animals. So now let us see what is happening during this gametogenesis. One thing that you have to remember is always, always gametes are haploid. I hope you may be aware. What do you mean by haploid or what do you mean by diploid? We human beings, we possess all our body cells, or others called somatic cells. All body cells or somatic cells in us, they are all diploid, having two sets of chromosomes. Out of these two sets of chromosomes, one set of chromosome with 22 autosomes plus one X or A chromosome has come from father, and another set of chromosome with 22 autosomes plus one X chromosome has come from mother. These two together form zygote, and zygote is always diploid, and gametes are haploid. Sperm and ovum are haploid in case of human beings. When they fuse, it results in zygote. Zygote is diploid. So gametes are always haploid cells. I repeat again, if you don't ask her, what is the primary sex organ in case of a human male, you have to tell it is a testis. What is the primary sex organ in case of the female? It is a ovary. So gonads are the primary sex organs. So this sex cell, male sex cell is male gamete. Female sex cell is female gamete. Gametes are always haploid cells. In some algae, the two gametes are so similar in appearance that it is not possible to categorize them into male and female gamete. Look here. These are the two gametes you have in some of the algae. If I ask you, out of this, which is the male gamete, which is the female gamete, it is not possible to tell at all. They are similar in their appearance. They are hence called homogametes or isogametes. Here, iso means a similar. Homo means a similar. So these are the two homogametes as you see in some algae.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, isogamous means morphologically similar, but function genetically?
Yeah. You tell me. Genetically similar or dissimilar?
Sir, it's dissimilar, sir, because it's sexual, I guess.
It is sexual. Okay. However, in a majority of sexually reproducing organisms, the gametes produced are of two morphologically distinct types. That means one gamete, male gamete, is distinct from the female gamete. In a majority of sexually reproducing organisms, the gametes produced are of two morphologically distinct types, what we say heterogametes. Homo means similar. Hetero means dissimilar. In such organisms, the male gamete is called antherozooid. This is in case of plants. The male gamete is called antherozooid or sperm. Also, we use the term sperm. And the female gamete is called egg or ovum. We use the term anthrozoa and or sperm in case of plants, and only sperm in case of animals. And the female gamete is called egg or ovum. You can see very clearly in this particular diagram, the large one, big one, what you see here is the female gamete, and the tiny one, small one, is the male gamete. And in case of human beings, you can see this is what larger one, spherical one, this is the egg or ovum, and this, the tadpole-like one, is the sperm. So these are the examples for heterogametes. The same thing. Now, isogametes are senior, analga, cladophora. What you generally do is that you will remember isogametes as something like that. If at all it is asked in the examination, what type of gametes you come across in a cladophora, isogametes, anisogametes, both, none of this, you will get to doubt, where is that? Where is that cladophora? Cladophora is not there in the NCERT book. No, that is a mistake. Therefore, even though this reference cladophora is there only in the figure, there is no reference of cladophora anywhere in the textbook, anywhere in the text matter. Therefore, you should remember cladophora is an example for isogametes. Whenever you say that you should remember, you must make it a point, underline this and put at the side, double a line and near that important. I hope you understand this point. So, like that, you come across heterogametes in alga fucus. This is the alga fucus. I hope whenever I say, now, you must also know that whenever it is said fucus, where this fucus comes? It belongs to which class? Can anyone tell me? Fucus belongs to which class? This is what I'm looking for. Whenever you study second year, you must know what are the examples for chlorophyce, what are the examples for pheophyce, what are the examples for rhodophyce. All these should be there at the tongue's tip, as I have told you yesterday. What are the examples for phycomyces, ascomyces, basidiomyces, deuteromyces? All these examples, you must start getting these examples right from now. And you should recall these examples whenever you take a bath or showers, whenever you brush your teeth, whenever you are sitting in a bus, or whenever you go to some other place in auto, at all the time, you start go on recalling these examples. There's the only way to memorize these examples. And in the examination hall, you should memorize these examples within a fraction of a second. Right? So, fucus, can anyone tell me? Fucus is an example for a chlorophyce, pheophyce, or rhodophyce?
Sir, rhodophyce.
Rhodophyce.
It
is a wrong guess. You have guessed it? No, it is a wrong. Okay?
Sir, pheophyce.
Yeah, pheophyce is correct. Yes? It is L-S-D-E-F. Some memory technique. L-S-D-E-F. L-S-D, you know. L-S-D, it is a drug. You are going to hear about that more. Somehow you have to remember chlorophyce, C-C-C-X-U-V, C-C-C, that is the chlorophyce. You have to remember, what is that C? What is that another C? What is one?
Chlamydomonas. Cladophora.
Cladophora, no, it is not mentioned in your NCERT book. I am asking about NCERT book mentioned example. Chlamydomonas, Chlorella, Chara, then Pyrogera,
Ultrix.
U, Ultrix. V, Volvox. Dutti, are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
Rakesh, are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
All of you should make it a point. Whenever you attend these classes, you must concentrate on the previous chapters also. It is very important, all the students, remember. So, now coming to these heterogametes of Homo sapiens, this is what you have in case of human beings also. Now, let us look into sexuality in organism. All these, whatever you are hearing now, whatever you are studying now, they are all going to be repeated in one or the other context later, or some of them are already taught in a class 11. Sexual reproduction in organisms generally involves the fusion of gametes from two different individuals. That is why it is sexual reproduction. But this is not always true. Is it that the gametes are produced by two different individuals? No, need not be. Gametes may be produced by the same individual. Then the answer to your question, whether genetically these gametes are same or different, you have to find out the answer. But this is not always true. From your recollection of examples studied in class 11, can you identify cases where self-fertilization is observed? Can you recall the examples from class 11?
Earthworm.
Where all you come across self-fertilization?
Earthworm.
Earthworm. Is it that earthworm has a self-fertilization?
Yes, sir.
Who said it?
Sir Karan.
Is it Karan correct? Rakesh, Diti, Srijan? Who else is there? Whether he is correct? Diti?
Sir?
Tell me, do you come across self-fertilization in earthworm? Karan, you are wrong. In earthworm, you come across what is called reciprocal cross-fertilization. Reciprocal cross-fertilization. Okay, so can you identify cases where self-fertilization is observed? Self-fertilization is observed in case of Tinea solium, tapeworm. Tapeworm shows self-fertilization. Of course, citing such example in plant is easy. Let us see. Plants may have both male and female reproductive structures in the same plant. What we call them? What do you call them? Apart from bisexual, what is another term? In plants, you use some other term for this bisexual. What is that?
Yes.
Pardon?
Dioecious.
Is it a dioecious? Wrong.
Monoecious.
Monoecious, sir.
Monoecious. I know. Diti, you are getting confused always. Am I right about this?
Yes, sir.
You just make it a point to remember. Sex is different. Dioecious, different. Sex is different, not in the same animal. Different. D for different. Bisexual is also called monoecious. Monoecious. Understood? Or
yes.
In animals it is called? Both in animals and plants it is others called?
Hermaphrodites.
Harma, not harmo. Harma, H-E-R-M-A, hermaphrodite. Or on different plants, what is called unisexual or dioecious. Right? Let us see now. This is earthworm. If you look at earthworm, in earthworm you see testes and also ovary. Earthworm, testes and ovary. Therefore, this is called hermaphrodite. Hermaphrodite. What do you see here? Cockroach, male with the testes, female with the ovary. So, cockroach is an example for unisexual animal or Diti, or?
Sir?
Cockroach, you are buying time. Cockroach is an example for unisexual or?
Monoecious. Dioecious, sorry, dioecious.
Srijan?
Sir?
Monoecious or dioecious?
Sir, dioecious.
Karan? Monoecious or
dioecious? Yes, sir. Sir, it is monoecious. Sir, dioecious.
Why still doubt? Dioecious means sexes are different. Okay? Don't get confused. You must be very much a thorough. And right now, you should make it a point to have that. Okay? It is a daishyas. Right? Now, look at the chara. In chara, what is the condition? What is the condition? You have both gonads in the same plane. What is this? Male sex organ. This is a female sex organ. As such, it is monoecious.
Monoecious.
Or
hermaphrodites.
Or harma. Don't say harmo. Harma.
Hermaphrodites.
Or
unisexual.
What?
Bisexual.
See, this monoecious, dioecious, unisexual, bisexual, hermaphrodite terms you should know very well. And at any time, even if at all you are made to wake up at midnight, you should tell what is dioecious, what is monoecious. Dite. Understood? Coming to Merkantia, what is this? Monoecious or dioecious?
It's dioecious, sir.
It is dioecious. Why?
Successor separate,
sir. Showing archegoniophore, female sex organ, and another is antheridiophore. It is a male thallus and a female thallus, so you come across dioecious. And this flower of sweet potato is bisexual. Come on. Understood? Right?
Yes, sir.
Now, don't look into the book. Who will tell me which is dioecious, which is monoecious? Whatever that examples you have studied, don't look into the book. Come on. Who will tell?
Sir, flower is dioecious. Sorry, monoecious. Flower is monoecious.
You are getting confused. I will ask this question in the next class. So, in several fungi and plants, terms such as homothallic and monoecious are used to denote bisexual condition. Homothallic and monoecious are used to denote the bisexual condition. That means both are present in the same thallus. And heterothallic and dioecious, hetero, dissimilar, di, dissimilar, not similar, different, are the terms used to describe unisexual condition. In the flowering plants, the unisexual male flower is a staminate. That means bearing the stamens. While the female is called pistillate or bearing the pistils. In some flowering plants, both male and female flowers may be present on the same individual. What is that condition called? Monoecious.
Monoecious.
In some flowering plants, both male and female flowers may be present on the same individual. Or on a separate individual, dioecious. Dioecious. Right? Male and female flowers may be present on the same individual, monoecious, or on separate individuals, dioecious. Now, is it that monoecious and unisexual are different or same?
Sir, different, sir.
Different, sir.
Monoecious and bisexual are same?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Now my question is there. Some examples of monoecious plants are cucurbits and coconuts. And of dioecious plants are papaya and a date palm. Some example for monoecious plants, cucurbit and coconut. Is it that monoecious plants, cucurbit and coconut. Is it that in the coconut, you have male coconut tree and female coconut tree?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No. In the same coconut, you come across male flowers, female flowers. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
In a cucurbit, do you know that? There are two types of flowers. Please try to understand this concept. What I'm telling you. A monoecious plant. Is it that monoecious plant has either only male flower or only female flower?
It has both male flower and female flower, sir.
In some plants, like a cucurbita, you have, what are the examples for cucurbita? Cucurbita?
Cucumber, sir.
Cucumber. Right? Ash gourd. You have these examples. In these, you see, in the same plant, you see male flower, female flower. In a coconut, you will see male flower, female flower. Do you know that? Here, papaya is a dioecious. Date palm is a dioecious. What do you mean by that? Sexes are different. In this, whenever the sexes are different, in papaya, whether the plant, male plant and female plant are different?
Yes, sir.
Or is it that in one papaya, you come across a male flower and a female flower?
No, sir.
No, sir.
In papaya, male plant is different from female plant. And a date palm, this is also, it is different. Name the type of gametes that are formed in staminate and pistillate flower. Staminate, it produces pollen grains, and pistillate flower produces eggs. Right? Now, you have in this cucurbit and coconuts, flower is unisexual. Am I right? One flower is a male, another flower is a female. But they are monoecious plants. What about animals? Are individuals of all species either male or female? Unisexual? Or are there species which possess both reproductive organs, bisexual? You know, already you have seen. What is that in a case of earthworm?
It has both male and female.
Earthworm is unisexual or bisexual?
Bisexual.
Bisexual.
Cockroach.
Unisexual.
Unisexual.
Frog. Cockroach.
Unisexual.
Unisexual.
Frog. Unisexual. Right from fishes. All vertebrates are unisexual. Now, if you recall, right from periphera, you can note down somewhere, right from periphera, let us see whether they are unisexual or bisexual. Can you recall? Sponges in periphera.
Unisexual, so bisexual, sir.
Bisexual. Coelenterates, hydra.
So they are unisexual, sir.
Pardon?
They are unisexual.
No, they are also bisexual. Ctenophora, bisexual. In Coelenterata, if you look into jellyfish, Aralia, they are unisexual. Hydra, sea anemone, all these are bisexual. Ctenophora, bisexual. Platyhelminthes, Planaria, both unisexual and bisexual. Sorry, Planaria, bisexual. Tapeworm, bisexual. Hermaphrodite. Liver fluke, bisexual. Neris, Emotionalida, unisexual. Earthworm, bisexual. Leech, bisexual. Are you taking down?
Yes, sir.
Jyoti?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, I'm taking down.
Srijan? Karan?
Yes, sir.
Ascherminthes, unisexual. Arthropoda, All are unisexual. Mollusca, all are unisexual. Echinodermata, all are unisexual. And hereupwards, Hemichordata, unisexual. Urochordata, bisexual. Cephalochordata, unisexual. Psychostomata, unisexual. Right from fishes to mammals, all are unisexual. So, earthworms, sponges, tapeworm, leech are all typical examples for bisexual animals that possess both male and female reproductive organs. They are also called hermaphrodites. Cockroach is an example of unisexual species. Your frog, fish, snakes, lizards, birds, they are all other examples for unisexual species. Look here. This is the diagram of earthworm enlarged. You see testes here. And over here, as such, it is bisexual. This is what is called a tapeworm. Tinea solia. What segmented part like that it appears? These are not true segments. These are pseudo segments. And each of these segments is called proglottate. And if you see the proglottate, in each proglottate, you come across testes and ovary. You have ovary and testes. So, whatever the gametes are produced here, they pass out. There will be a pore here, genital pore. Through this genital pore, sperm comes out. What it does? It just enters the genital pore of immediate next pseudo segment. From here, it may enter to here. From here, it may enter here. So, the gametes produced are genetically different because these are all different structures. We have here self-fertilization. Self-fertilization here. Right? This is the diagram of a leech with the gonads. All these, what you see, these are, they all testes. And you have this over here, ovisac. So, male reproductive parts and female reproductive parts. It is of leech. This diagram is of leech. Leech reproductive system. So, leech is a bisexual animal. Cockroach, unisexual. Testes and ovary in two different individuals. Unisexual. Now, let us study what type of cell division occur during gamete formation. What is the answer? What type of
cell division? Both mitotic and meiotic, sir. Depends upon the...
Both mitotic and meiotic type of cell divisions occur during gamete formation. Gametes, in all heterogametic species are the species which produce two types of gametes, that means the dissimilar gametes. Gametes in all heterogametic species are of two types, namely male and female. I have already told you, they are also called male and female sex cells. Gametes are haploid, though the parent plant body from which they arise may be either haploid or diploid. Very important, gametes are not haploid, but the parent plant body which produces gametes may be haploid or diploid. The haploid parent produces gametes by mitotic division, and it is characteristic of plants only. Very important concept. So, whenever we say that gametes are haploid, in animals, invariably, of course, there is some exception. In general, mostly, it is better to use the term mostly. Mostly, the parent is diploid in animals. But in plants, even the haploid parent produces gametes by mitotic division. And if at all you look into honeybee, in honeybee, you know, there are three types of individuals. One is worker. Another one is male, what is called drone. And one more is called the queen. Queen is female, worker is female, but workers are sterile. Queen is fertile, and diploid queen produces haploid eggs. Workers are sterile, no question producing the gametes at all. Male honeybee, remember, male honeybee is haploid, and haploid male honeybee produces sperms by mitotic division. Very important concept to remember. A haploid parent produces gametes by mitotic division. Does this mean that meiosis never occurs in organisms that are haploid? Meiosis never occurs in organisms that are haploid? No. Meiosis never occurs. Careful examination of flowchart of life cycle of algae that you studied in class 11 to get a suitable answer. You will answer that. What is that? Look here. This is what you have. Several organisms belonging to Monera, fungi, algae, and bryophytes have haploid plant body. I said haploid plant body, parent is haploid, and it produces haploid sperms also. Haploid plant body, but in organisms belonging to pteridophytes, gymnosperms, and angiosperms, most of the animals, including human beings, parental body is diploid. Very important concept. Remember, several organisms belonging to Monera, which includes bacteria mainly, fungi, algae, and bryophytes, they have haploid plant body. Parent is haploid. And pteridophytes, gymnosperms, and angiosperms are with the diploid plant body. Parent is diploid. Very, very important concept you must remember. It is obvious that meiosis, the reduction division, has to occur if a diploid body has to produce haploid gametes. Therefore, meiosis occurs in the individuals where parental bodies are diploid. In diploid organisms, specialized cells called meiocytes, that is gamete mother cell, undergo meiosis. We call it meiocytes. Of course, we are going to study details of this in our next chapter, that is the sexual reproduction in flowering plants. At the end of meiosis, only one set of chromosome gets incorporated into each gamete. Therefore, each gamete is said to be haploid, right? Carefully study table 1.1 and fill in the diploid and haploid chromosome numbers of organisms. Let us see that. Okay, now you tell me, human beings, what is chromosome number in meiocyte? What is meiocyte? Meiocyte is the one which shows meiosis. Here, in case of human being, meiocytes are called?
Microspore mother cell.
In human being? Human being?
Mother cell, sir.
Huh?
Mother cell, microspore.
In human being, the meiocytes are called either spermatocytes or oocytes. In a human being, you know, primary spermatocyte undergoes division and forms first meiotic division and forms secondary spermatocyte. It undergoes second meiotic division and forms spermatids. So, in human beings, it is called primary spermatocyte in male and primary oocyte in case of female. So 46 is the diploid number, 2n, haploid number is 23. Housefly, what is the diploid number? 12. What is the chromosome number in gametes? Come on. Hello.
6, sir.
6. Rat, what should be the number here?
42.
42. Dog, what should be the number here? 39,
sir.
39. Cat?
38.
Fruit fly?
4.
4. Opioglossum?
1290. 1290
Why? Apple?
17.
17, sir.
Rice?
24.
Maize?
10.
10.
Potato?
48.
Butterfly?
190.
Onion?
16.
16.
How much is written here?
8.
In your book? Are you possessing NCERT book with you?
Yes, sir.
800.
How much it is written?
8, sir.
Is it in all textbooks it is 8? Or you get the number, other number? If at all there is some other number, make a correction that it has a 8 and what should be a
16, sir.
16. And this table you have to by heart. You have to by heart. Right? And I may ask this number at any time in my class. And at that time you must be in a position to say, sir, Apple has in mu set this number and in gamut this number. Butterfly this number, this number. Opiogrossum this number. And it is very important and it is always asked in the examination. Now let us study gamut transfer. After their formation, the male and female gametes must be physically brought together to facilitate fusion. That is fertilization. The gametes should come near each other to get united. Have you ever wondered how the gametes meet? Is it that all the gametes, both the gametes, male and female gametes, are motile? Need not be. In a majority of organisms, male gamete is motile and the female gamete is stationary. It has no flagella. It cannot move. Male gamete is motile. It can swim in water. Exceptions are, there are certain exceptions. In majority of the organisms, male gamete is motile and female gamete is stationary. It won't move. Exceptions are few fungi and algae in which both types of gametes are motile. Whenever the gametes possess a flagella, it is an indication that they are motile. See here? Motile, motile. Fusion gametes results in the formation of zygote. It develops into a new individual. Graphically, it is shown. Diagrammatically, it is shown. New individual. Right? It is homogametic contact in alga. Both these gametes are of same type. You cannot say which is male and which is female. Isogametes. And here you can see germinating pollen grains. Pollen grains, they germinate and they pass on the stigma and they pass down. Again, we are going to study about this in detail in the next chapter. There is a need for medium through which the male gametes move. When we say that male gametes are motile, how they move? Is it they fly in air? No. Motile gamete means they must be released in water and they must swim there. There is a need for a medium, what you call aquatic medium, water medium, through which the male gametes move towards the female gamete. In several simple plants like algae, bryophytes, and pteridophytes, water is the medium through which this gamete transfer takes place. A large number of male gametes, however, fail to reach the female gamete. It is not that even they are motile, they can swim. There is no guarantee that each male gamete meets the female gamete. It is a chance factor. As such, during this gamete formation, male gametes are always produced in an enormous number. Enormous number to compensate. A large number of male gametes have failed to reach the female gamete. So what? to compensate this loss of male gametes during transport, because many of the gametes die without any female gamete, the number of male gametes produced is several thousand times more than the number of female gametes produced. Female gametes produced are always less, and male gametes are produced more because a good number of male gametes, they fail to reach the female gamete. Therefore, always male gametes are produced in a large number than the female gametes, even in the internal fertilization. In a seed plant.
Sir.
Yes.
Definition of the motility. Motility.
What is the definition? Come on. Anyone? Motile. What is the definition? What is motile gamete? Sujan?
Sir, ability of an organism to swim or move.
Motile gamete is moving gamete, swimming gamete, gamete which is capable of swimming, which is capable of moving on its own with the help of structures like a flagella. In seed plants, the pollen grains are the carriers of male gametes, and ovule have the egg. Seed plants, angiosperms. Pollen grains produced in anther, therefore, have to be transferred to the stigma before it can lead to fertilization. Pollen grains produced in anther, therefore, have to be transported to the stigma before they can lead to fertilization. How this transfer takes place to stigma? By different agents.
Pollination.
What are these pollinating agents?
Sir, there are two types
insects.
Of agents. Biotic and abiotic.
Yeah, abiotic.
Biotic is...
it may be help insects. Of, it help of animals.
And abiotic is wind and hair. So yeah. Wind and hair, both are same. Wind and water, sorry.
This is what you already seen. Now, in bisexual self-fertilizing plants, example, peas, transfer of pollen grains to the stigma is relatively easy. Why? It is bisexual. Both pollen grains and the eggs are produced by the same plant. In bisexual self-fertilizing plants, like peas, transfer of pollen grains to the stigma is relatively easy as anthers and stigma are located close to each other. Close to each other. Pollen grains, so soon after they are shed, they come in contact with the stigma. So it is self-fertilizing plant. The pollen grains of that plant or flower fertilize the egg of the same flower. But in cross-pollinating plants, including dioecious plants, a specialized event called pollination facilitates transfer of pollen grains to the stigma. Pollination facilitates the transfer of pollen grains to the stigma. So, pollen grains germinate on the stigma. After falling there on the stigma, they germinate, and the pollen tubes carrying the male gametes reach the ovule and discharge the male gametes near the egg. We are going to study in detail in the next chapter. In the dioecious animals, since male and female gametes are formed in a different individual, the organism must evolve a special mechanism for gamete transfer. This is what you already heard. Abiotic and biotic factors help in that. Agencies help in that. Successful transfer and coming together of gamete is essential for the most critical event in sexual reproduction, the fertilization. Successful transfer and coming together of gamete, male gamete to the female gamete, is essential for the most critical event in sexual reproduction called fertilization. You know, during fertilization, the nucleus, male nucleus, fuses with the female nucleus. Now let us study fertilization. The most vital event of sexual reproduction is perhaps the fusion of gametes. You know, this process is called syngamy. Syngamy, gametes fuse. Syngamy. This process called syngamy results in the formation of diploid zygote. You may be asked, what is syngamy? Syngamy is fusion of gametes. And these gametes, as you know, they are haploid. So fertilization is a process also called syngamy, where formation of diploid zygote takes place. The term fertilization is also often used for this process. Syngamy and fertilization are one and the same, synonymous word. The term syngamy and fertilization are frequently used, though interchangeably. Sometimes we call syngamy or fertilization means fusion of a male gamete in the female gamete. What would happen if syngamy does not occur? If the syngamy does not occur, zygote formation won't take place. If the zygote formation does not take place, it will not develop into a new individual. Offspring is not produced. However, it has to be mentioned here that in some organisms like rotifers, honeybees, and even some lizards and birds like a turkey, the female gamete undergoes the development to form new organism without fertilization. There are certain animals, there are certain organisms where you will not see syngamy, where you will not see fertilization. And development of an organism or development of an unfertilized egg, hidden organism is called parthenogenesis. What is parthenogenesis? Parthenogenesis is development of unfertilized egg into a new individual. Unfertilized egg. Unfertilized egg means this egg is not fused with the sperm. This phenomenon is called parthenogenesis. Where you come across? In all these, you come across that. Yes? Including some birds. Yes? Including some lizards, amongst the reptiles and birds, honeybees, amongst the insects, and you also have another invertebrate, what is called a rotifer, living in water. Okay, look here. This is what a lizard, a New Mexico whiptail lizard, it is known to reproduce by parthenogenesis, where the eggs laid by this individual develops into a new individual. Parthenogenesis occurs in turkeys, bird, through the doubling of haploid cells. Just remember, don't worry much about the details of this. Where does the syngamy occur? We have seen that. Syngamy is a fusion of gametes. Where does syngamy occur? In most aquatic organisms, such as majority of algae and fishes, as well as amphibians, syngamy occurs in the external medium water. Where majority of algae, which are aquatic, and fishes, you know they are aquatic. Amphibians, you know, even though they live on the land, for the purpose of reproduction, they come to water. Syngamy occurs in the external medium water, that is outside the body of the organism. This type of gametic fusion is called external fertilization. I hope you know fertilization is of two types, external and internal. So, fusion of gametes in the outside medium, that is external medium, this water is called external fertilization. I hope you are hearing me. Are you attentive?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Jyoti? Jyoti? See. This type of gametic fusion is called external fertilization. Organisms exhibiting external fertilization show great synchrony between the sexes and release a larger number of gametes. Organism exhibiting external fertilization show great synchrony. What is that? Synchrony means they must release the gametes almost at the same time. Male gametes are produced by another organism. Female gametes are produced by another organism. And the timing of the production of these gametes should get synchronized. Organisms exhibiting external fertilization show great synchrony between the sexes and release a large number of gametes into the surrounding medium, that is water, in order to enhance the chances of syngamy. This happens in the bony fishes and frogs, where a large number of offspring are produced. In the bony fishes and frogs, where a large number of offspring are produced. Remember, there are another category of fishes called cartilaginous fishes. What you call them also? Cartilaginous fishes. Other is called? Chondrichthyes. Bony fishes, or other is called Osteichthyes fishes. This happens in bony fishes, Osteichthyes, and frogs, where a large number of offspring are produced. A major disadvantage is that the offspring are extremely vulnerable to a predator. Even the egg is vulnerable to a predator, threatening their survival up to the adulthood. Or even after fertilization, the fertilized egg, they are also eaten by their predator. Or the early stage developmental embryonic stages, they are also eaten by predator. That is the major disadvantage of external fertilization. In many terrestrial organisms, is it clear so far? Whatever studied? Srijan?
Yes, sir.
Karan?
Yes, sir.
Rakesh?
Yes, sir.
Duty, are you there?
Yes, sir, I am there.
You were not there when I asked a question a few minutes before.
Sir, my dad switched off the net switch, so I got disconnected for 2 minutes. I had to leave the class.
No, it should not happen.
Yes, sir, that was my mistake.
That is the specialty of online classes.
No, sir, really, I got disconnected, that's why.
Where does syngamy occur? Now, fusion of gametes, where it occurs? In most aquatic organisms, such as majority of algae and fishes, as well as amphibians, syngamy occurs in the... Is it over? Sorry.
Yes, sir. No. It's over.
No. Yes, sir.
In many terrestrial organisms belonging to fungi, higher animals such as reptiles, birds, mammals, and in the majority of plants like bryophytes, pteridophytes, and gymnosperms and angiosperms, syngamy occurs inside the body. Syngamy occurs inside the body of the organism, hence the process is called internal fertilization. Okay? All these show internal fertilization, where sperms are directly introduced into the body of the female. In all these organisms, egg is formed inside the female body, where they fuse with the male gamete. In organisms exhibiting internal fertilization, the male gamete is motile and has to reach the egg in order to fuse with it. In this, even though the number of sperms produced is very large, there is a significant reduction in the number of eggs produced. Remember, even in internal fertilization, the sperm is produced in a large number, but the egg produced is always significantly, number of eggs produced is always significantly reduced. In seed plants, however, the non-motile male gametes are carried to female gametes by pollen tubes. Flowering plants, seed plants. However, the non-motile male gametes are carried to female gamete by pollen tubes. Now, we shall look into post-fertilization events. We have studied sexual reproduction with reference to pre-fertilization event, fertilization, and now we are looking to post-fertilization events. Events in sexual reproduction after the formation of zygote are called post-fertilization events. Events in sexual reproduction after the formation of zygote are called post-fertilization events. Yes, that is after fertilization. Let us see what is happening. You know, the fusion of the sperm with the egg results in zygote. Formation of the diploid zygote is universal in all sexually reproducing organisms. Whenever haploid gamete, male gamete, fuses with the haploid female gamete, it results in diploid fertilized egg called zygote. In organisms with external fertilization, zygote is formed in the external medium, that is usually water. Whereas in those exhibiting internal fertilization, zygote is formed inside the body of the organism. Further, development of the zygote depends on the type of life cycle the organism has and the environment it is exposed to. Remember, further development of the zygote. Once the zygote is formed, further development of the zygote depends on the type of life cycle of the organism has and the environment it is exposed to. We are going to see that in detail one by one in different types of plants and animals. In organisms belonging to fungi and algae, zygote develops a thick wall that is resistant to desiccation and damage. Zygote is well protected and it undergoes a period of rest before germination, where in case of fungi and algae, zygote undergoes a period of rest before germination. In organisms, it's a haplantic life cycle. You have studied haplantic.
It's actually completed, sir.
No, it is a little bit different. In a haplantic, in organisms with haplantic life cycle, you know, in case of plants, you come across haplantic, diplantic, haplodiplantic. In organisms with haplantic life cycle, zygote divides by meiosis to form haploid spores that grow into haploid individual. Where? In haplantic life cycle. Haploid individual. Zygote divides by meiosis to form haploid spores that grow into haploid individual. You know, you have Merkantia. What is that, Merkantia? Bryophyte. The parents are haploid. Look at your 11th standard book and find out what kind of development takes place in a zygote in organisms in the diplontic and haplodiplontic life cycle. This is the diplontic and is haplodiplontic. Zygote is a vital link that ensures continuity of the species between organisms of one generation and the next. Every sexually reproducing organism, including human beings, begin life as a single cell. That's a zygote. Right? Some of these life cycles you have studied in the last year. Now let us look into embryogenesis. Embryogenesis is the formation of embryo. Embryogenesis refers to the process of development of embryo from the zygote. Zygote undergoes a repeated rapid mitotic division, which is referred to as a cleavage in case of animals. During embryogenesis, zygote undergoes a cell division, mitotic type of cell division, and cell differentiation. While cell divisions increase the number of cells in the developing embryo, cell differentiation helps groups of cells to undergo certain modification to form specialized tissues and organs to form an organism. We have studied about the process of cell division and differentiation in the 11th standard. Animals are categorized into further oviparous and viviparous. You know, oviparous animals are the ones which lay eggs. Viviparous animals are the ones which give birth to young ones. Animals are categorized into oviparous and viviparous based on whether the development of the zygote takes place outside the body of the female parent or inside. If the development of the zygote takes place outside the body of the female parent or inside, that means whether they lay fertilized or unfertilized eggs or give birth to young ones. If they lay fertilized or unfertilized eggs, whatever it may be, they are oviparous. If they give birth to young ones, they are called viviparous. There is another term called ovoviviparous also. Let us see. In oviparous animals, which are oviparous animals? Reptiles, birds, even your fishes, oviparous animals. But here, in oviparous animals like reptiles and birds, the fertilized eggs covered by hard calcareous shell are laid in a safe place in the environment. After a period of incubation, young ones hatch out. Who will tell me what is that eggs are called which possess a hard calcareous shell? There's one term. What is that term? Eggs with the hard calcareous shell. They are called by one term. That is, cleidoic eggs. Cleidoic eggs are the eggs with the calcareous shell. Right? Dithi, are you there?
Yes, sir, I'm there.
Cleidoic eggs. Cleidoic eggs are the ones which are with the hard calcareous shell. Where you see them? In reptiles and birds. They lay calcareous shell in a safe place in the environment. After a period of incubation, young ones hatch out. I hope it is understood. Look here. On the other hand, in viviparous animals, majority of mammals, including human beings, they are viviparous. Viviparous. Give birth to young ones. The zygote develops into a young one inside the body of the female organism. After attaining a certain stage of growth, the young ones are delivered out of the body of the female organism by what is called parturition. Because of proper embryonic care and protection, the chances of survival of young ones is greater in viviparous organism, because all early stage of development takes place inside the body of the female. Understood? Now you have another term, what is called ovoviviparous. What is ovoviviparous? Here, fertilized eggs kept inside the mother until born. They are retained in the body of the mother until born. It is the most common form of development. Eggs get nutrition through yolk sac, produces large embryos. Eggs hatch inside the mother and then are born. Provides a better shelter. Examples for ovoviviparous, remember some of these shark are examples for ovoviviparous. I have some other examples also. You have the screenshot of this and later you can add to that to your notes. Ovoviviparous. Ovoviviparous condition is the one where the eggs are retained in the body of the mother, but remember, mother never provides any food to this developing young one. Mother never puts directly, never feeds this young one, and young one, developing one, has to depend on whatever the yolk that is contained in the egg, and mother provides only shelter to the developing young one or growing young one, only place to get accommodated. Ovoviviparous, their young develop inside eggs which are held within the mother's body. Young one develops inside the egg which are held within the mother's body until they hatch and are then birthed by the mother, or then they come out of the mother fully developed and independent.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, where will the eggs go, sir, after the organism is born inside the you? Insert the organism.
No, when the organism is born, the born comes out, the young one comes out, and whatever that remaining part of that egg that is already gets utilized and it degenerates.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Now we have another example. Monotreme, platypus and echidna. These are the eggling mammals. The oviparous monotreme, I said, subclass, what are the three subclasses of class of mammalia? Anyone? What are the three subclasses of class mammalia? Very bad. I have told about this in my yesterday's class. What are the three subclasses of class mammalia?
Protoria.
Yeah.
Protoria and Metatheria.
And Eutheria. I know that you are reading and telling. Dutti, are you there?
Yes, sir, I'm there.
Why don't you remember that? That means, whatever you have studied, you are not making pakka on that day itself. This is one of the most important things that is required. So, Prototheria includes, I said, one order, living order called Monotremata. So, Monotremata includes a platypus, duck-billed platypus, what is called Ornithorhynchus, and echidna, it is a spiny anteater. So that hold their eggs within their bodies for most of the gestation period. And the eggs are then laid and hatch within few days. Look here. This is what young one of a platypus. So cute. Am I right? Young one comes out. And you have another one, what is called yolk sac placenta. What is that? Definition of yolk sac placenta. I have the screenshot of this and add it to your notes. A structure. Look here. This is what you have. The shark fish. And this is the egg. From where this embryo develops. Yolk sac placenta. You must remember that there is another type of placenta called yolk sac placenta. A structure in some sharks resembling a placenta consisting of vascular embryonic yolk sac. Well, yolk sac wall intimately associated with the vascular, maternal, uterine, ovital wall and serving to nourish the embryo. So what happens in some shark and all, the eggs are retained inside the body and from the top of the eggs, the embryo develops. And once this all yolk is utilized, it grows sufficient big enough and it comes out. And this is called yolk sac placenta. Just remember, yolk sac placenta is the placenta formed from the egg containing the yolk and it is present in shark-like organisms, animals. See, the shark embryo shown here is a product of meroblastic cleavage. I shall tell about holoblastic meroblastic cleavage later. during the chapter Human Reproduction, in which only a portion of the cytoplasm is cleaved, not to the large yolk sac attached to an embryo. Not to the large yolk sac. This is a large yolk, amount of yolk present in the egg, only from the this upper part, only from here the embryo develops. And the rest of the part will be having full of yolk. When the embryo develops, it makes use of complete makes use of this. And why that happens and all, I shall explain that in another class. So this is embryo with the yolk sac placenta. This is yolk sac placenta. Placenta formed from the yolk of this egg. In flowering plants, the zygote is formed inside the ovule. After fertilization, the sepals, petals, and stamens of the flower wither and fall down. Can you name a plant in which the sepals remain attached? We shall study. The pistil, however, remains attached to the plant. The zygote develops into the embryo and the ovules develop into the seed. The ovary develops into the fruit, which develops a thick wall called pericarp that is protective in function. We are going to study that, and some aspect you already studied. After dispersal, seeds will germinate under favorable condition to produce new plants. Look here. This is what? A few kinds of fruits showing seeds and a protective covering. That is the pericarp. So, with this chapter got over. We are going to meet in the next chapter. Next chapter that I'm going to cover, take up, is a sexual reproduction in flowering plants.